Good evening. For our prelude this evening, two members of our music staff are going to play some music. First, Matt Genders is coming to play a movement from one of the Bach suites. Bach wrote six unaccompanied suites for cello that have several movements in them each, and they have no accompaniment, but wonderful lines and colors through them, and he's going to play one of those, and then he and Brian Anderson will play a movement from Beethoven for you. This is music offered for God's glory, for your encouragement, and Bach himself was the one who used to write Sole Deo Gloria at the end of his compositions, giving God the glory for whatever might come of them, and that is the title of our prelude.
Thank you. Well, good evening and welcome to 10th Church. I suppose some of you want to be here, and maybe some of you don't. My four-year-old doesn't really want to be here right now. And I'm working with him, you know. But if you don't, perhaps you feel like, oh, yet again, I'm here. Perhaps you will find something tonight that surprises you. And we are here to worship God, to get to know him and what he has in store for us. And he promises us there are good things. And I want to tell you that as I welcome you here to 10th Church this evening. And I hope that you find this to be a place that's encouraging to you, even if perhaps that's not necessarily what you'd like to hear tonight. We do hope that you are encouraged and that you hear about God and you hear about Jesus and the gospel. So welcome to 10th Church.
And we start with the word of God, and I'm going to read from Isaiah chapter 52. How beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of him who brings good news, who publishes peace, who brings good news of happiness, who publishes salvation, who says to Zion, your God reigns. Let's pray. Our gracious God, our great God, we bow before you this evening. We thank you for this reminder, this great message, this good news to Zion, this publication of your great rescue package for humanity, that you are the God who reigns, that is, you are supreme, you are the monarch of the universe, you are an absolute monarch, you rule over all. You're answerable to no one. There's no democratic aspect to your monarchy. You reign over our lives. You reign over history. You write the script of our story and of the story of humanity. And it is our task, as it were, to find our place in that story, that narrative that you have written for us. And as we come tonight, we come acknowledging that you are God, a God alone, that you are great and glorious and splendid and beautiful and majestic and all-powerful. And we adore you. We use that language at a human level of people that we adore, but when we come before you, we want to say in a way and in a measure and to a degree that it does not compare with any other adoration that we have of people or things, that we adore you in a place all by yourself. You are above us. You are apart from us. You are over us. And we worship, we love, we adore, we magnify your name through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. Please be seated. We're going to pray together now. Holy Father in heaven, we are so grateful to be here tonight to worship you. Thank you for everyone here who's come to hear your word. And we pray that tonight the good news of Jesus Christ would take root in our hearts and transform our lives, that in everything we do, we would strive to glorify you. Help us to kill our sin, to flee from it, that we would be above reproach. But we know, Lord, we are unable to do any of this without you, without your help. And we forget this often. So we pray that you would remind us of this sobering truth, Lord. Rid us of our self-centered and self-righteous mindsets, that we would depend solely on you in every aspect of our lives, in our work, in our schooling, in our families, in our relationships, that we would just submit everything to you. And we pray that tonight you would quiet all of our hearts and our minds, and open our ears that we would be attentive as your word is taught to us. Be with the pastor as he preaches to us, that he may boldly and faithfully proclaim your truth. And we ask all these things in the name of Jesus. Jesus, who was once despised for our sake. Jesus, who suffered to release us from sin, and who is worthy of all worship, honor, power, and blessing. In his name, amen. We're going to be reading in God's word from Acts 21. So please turn there. If you don't have your Bibles with you, it's okay, because there's the church Bible in the pew rack in front of you, and that's on page 930, Acts 21. And we are going to be reading through verse 26. So let's pay close attention as we read God's word. And when we had parted from them and set sail, we came by straight course to Kos, and the next day to Rhodes, and from there to Patara. And having found a ship crossing to Phoenicia, we went aboard and set sail. When we had come in sight of Cyprus, leaving it on the left, we sailed to Syria and landed at Tyre, for there the ship was to unload its cargo. And having sought out the disciples, we stayed there for 7 days. And through the Spirit, they were telling Paul not to go to Jerusalem. When our days there were ended, we departed and went on our journey, and they all, with wives and children, accompanied us until we were outside the city. And kneeling down on the beach, we prayed and said farewell to one another. Then we went on board the ship, and they returned home. When we had finished the voyage from Tyre, we arrived at Ptolemais, and we greeted the brothers and stayed with them for 1 day. On the next day, we departed and came to Caesarea, and we entered the house of Philip the evangelist, who was one of the seven, and stayed with him. He had four unmarried daughters who prophesied. While we were staying for many days, a prophet named Agabus came down from Judea. And coming to us, he took Paul's belt and bound his own feet and hands and said, "Thus says the Holy Spirit, this is how the Jews at Jerusalem will bind the man who owns this belt and deliver him into the hands of the Gentiles." When we heard this, we and the people there urged him not to go up to Jerusalem. Then Paul answered, "What are you doing, weeping and breaking my heart? For I am ready not only to be imprisoned, but even to die in Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus." And since he would not be persuaded, we ceased and said, "Let the will of the Lord be done." After these days, we got ready and went up to Jerusalem. And some of the disciples from Caesarea went with us, bringing us to the house of Mnason of Cyprus, an early disciple with whom we should lodge. When we had come to Jerusalem, the brothers received us gladly. On the following day, Paul went in with us to James, and all the elders were present. After greeting them, he related one by one the things that God had done among the Gentiles through his ministry. And when they heard it, they glorified God. And they said to him, "You see, brother, how many thousands there are among the Jews of those who have believed. They are all zealous for the law, and they have been told about you that you teach all the Jews who are among the Gentiles to forsake Moses, telling them not to circumcise their children or walk according to our customs. What then is to be done?"
They will certainly hear that you have come. Do therefore what we tell you. We have four men who are under a vow. Take these men and purify yourself along with them and pay their expenses so they may shave their heads. Thus all will know that there is nothing in what they have been told about you, but that you yourself also live in observance of the law. But as for the Gentiles who have believed, we have sent a letter with our judgment that they should abstain from what has been sacrificed to idols and from blood and from what has been strangled and from sexual immorality. Then Paul took the men, and the next day he purified himself along with them and went into the temple, giving notice when the day of purification would be fulfilled and the offering presented for each one of them. This ends the reading of God's word.
Well, please keep your Bibles open at that reading that we've just had this evening. I'm trying to get back into the way of doing this preaching thing, which I haven't been doing for 3 weeks, so you'll have to forgive me if I haven't quite got my stride back. Basically, I would preach every day if I could, and would not take any Sundays off. My wife insists that I do, but the last three Sundays were not holiday. I want you to know that. They were not vacation. They were imposed on me as a form of punishment. And I endured it manfully, and I'm glad it's all over. Now, we're back here in Acts. Acts is coming to an end, and I want you to, we're going to be taking some big chunks, and we're going to take a big chunk tonight, but it's not going to take a lot of time. It's a big chunk of Scripture, but I'm going to make it as brief as possible this evening because we have communion in a moment. We use the word faith in a variety of ways, don't we, in our lives. We engage faith in a variety of ways. For example, you had faith this evening. You came along to this church and you sat down in these pews. For all you know, the pews could have been rigged, like I did once with a friend of mine, because we knew that these people sat in the same place every week, and we kind of rigged it up so that when they came in and they sat down, the pew collapsed, and it caused a bit of chaos. Well, I haven't done that for a long while, but you never know what might happen. So I want you to keep on exercising faith that when you come here and you sit down, that pew is going to take your weight. We exercise faith in a different sense, of course, when we engage ourselves to trust in what the Lord Jesus has accomplished for us, what we call saving faith. We trust in Him. We rest, to use the language of our confession, we rest on Christ, we receive Him, we rest on Him, we put our weight on Him, we regard Him as being able to take us because He has done all that is required for us in order to bring us to God. We don't need anybody else, we only need Jesus. He's our passport into heaven, a ticket into heaven. He's the only one on whose work alone we are assured of acceptance by God into His presence. So we use faith in that sense. But tonight I want to use faith in another sense, and it's also used in the Bible. We might say that faith is a four-letter word, spelt R-I-S-K, risk. Faith involves risk. And this is to do not with salvation. This is to do not with your relationship with God, but it does have to do with what might happen to you, what might fall out in your life. And we find this illustrated in this chapter. We find it illustrated in two ways in this chapter that we're going to see in a moment. Now, I wonder if, as we read it, whether you felt that this chapter was really a kind of incidental thing. It's kind of filler, because here we have a record of a number of journeys from A to B, from B to C, from C to D, and so on. And it starts off where Paul was, and it takes Paul to Jerusalem, and we know that Paul's ultimate goal is to get to Rome, but he wants to go back to Jerusalem, en route to Rome. He's completing the circle, in other words, that has begun early on in the book of Acts, where from Jerusalem into Judea, then Samaria, and then to the Gentile lands, the gospel has gone out from Jerusalem into the world. The prophets predicted that that's what would happen, and that has been worked out. Jesus said that is what would happen, and it's been worked out in the story of the book of Acts. But now the main goal is Rome, Rome the capital of the empire, Rome that symbolized in their day the ends of the earth, Rome that stands for the world in its largeness, in its completeness. Now the gospel is going to go straight from Jerusalem to Rome, and Paul is going to be the one that God will use to get the gospel to Rome. But first, he has to go to Jerusalem. And there's a lot of emotion in this passage. Did you notice that? In verse 1, for example, of chapter 21, we see emotion. When we had parted from them. Actually, in the Greek, the word is when we had torn ourselves away from them. When we torn ourselves away from them. Here is a farewell that's going on here. If you glance back into chapter 20 there, the chapters are unhelpful here. The divisions are unhelpful. But at the end of chapter 20, you do notice that in verse 36, 37, there was much weeping on the part of all. They embraced Paul and they kissed him, being sorrowful most of all because of the word he had spoken, that they would not see his face again after we had torn ourselves away from them. That's the context of that. And then in verse 13, do you see when Paul says to these people, "Why are you weeping and breaking my heart?" In other words, this is a very personal, very emotional situation. It's involving people, real people. Paul is a real person. He has real feelings. He is held in great affection by those who know him. They love him. He loves them. If you read Paul's letters, you'll find that he's constantly referring to people by name that he knows. You read the end of the book of Romans and you've got nearly a whole chapter given over to the names of people that he recognizes and that he knows in Rome and that he's looking forward to seeing. Paul is a people person. He is no remote atmospheric academic. He is a person engaged with real people in the world, and they loved him. They loved him because he loved them back. Well, in this chapter, we're going to look at the heart of the apostle. And as he goes from to Jerusalem and then on to Rome, his faith is marked by a willingness to risk everything for Jesus. Let me put it in two statements. First of all, he is willing to risk his life for the sake of the gospel. That's the first statement. Second statement, he is willing to risk his reputation for the sake of the gospel. Let's look at both of those things together. He's willing to risk his life for the sake of the gospel. That's really what verses 1 to 16 are all about. Did you notice that throughout that little section, we are reminded of warnings that the apostle received? In the midst of the heart-rending farewells, there is a sense that has gripped the friends of the apostle that this move of his, this visit of his to Jerusalem, is of a magnitude, a magnitude that is just overwhelming for them and difficult for them to grasp. If you look back to chapter 20, verse 23, you'll find that we're told there that in every city that he went to, in every city that Paul went to, on his way to Miletus, where this farewell takes place, the Holy Spirit was telling him the same thing. People were coming up to him, telling him that the Spirit had impressed this upon their hearts. And what was the Holy Spirit telling him? He says this, "I only know that in every city, the Holy Spirit warns me that prison and hardships are facing me." This was Paul's future, prison and hardships. And how did Paul interpret those Spirit-prompted predictions? He took those predictions as prophecies, not as permission to avoid what lay ahead. In other words, he heard what was being said to him. He heard all these messages, prison and hardships, suffering. That's ahead for you, Paul. But Paul took these as Spirit-anointed, Spirit-given intimations
of what God's agenda for him was, not as divine permissions to avoid it, or even as commands to avoid it. He had decided, he resolved in his own heart, that he would take whatever was coming to him for the sake of Christ. Now, we know that this apostle had a clear idea of what the will of God for him was. The Ephesian elders understood that prison and hardship awaited. Jerusalem is mentioned three times in this passage, and each time it's the place where the apostle was going to suffer. And it's interesting that in the book of Luke, which is in two parts, the book we call Luke and the book we call Acts, the book of Luke as a whole, in its two volumes, has a lot to say about Jerusalem. If you look at volume one, Jerusalem comes onto the scene as the place where Jesus, the Messiah, is going to suffer. In volume two, Jerusalem is the place where the Apostle Paul is going to suffer. In book one, Jesus, we're told, set his face steadfastly like a flint to go to Jerusalem to suffer there. The language that's used of Jesus is language that comes from Isaiah chapter 50, verse 7, where the servant of the Lord, God's anointed servant, says this, I have set my face like a flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. The servant of the Lord sets his face to suffer whatever lies ahead for him, and Jesus sets his face like a flint to go to Jerusalem. And so when we get to volume two and we find Paul, who is the servant of the servant of the Lord, the apostle Paul sets his face to go to Jerusalem and take what's coming to him there. He's walking in the master's footprints. He wants to take the route the master went. He understands that in the economy of God's grace, at this time in salvation history, at this moment that is unique in the history of the church and the world, that Jesus' apostles have been appointed by Jesus to follow his footsteps so that they, along with him, will be the testimony that you and I need as we live our Christian lives, the testimony of the authenticity of the message that has been delivered by them to the church and which we now have in our scripture. So Paul's way is the way of Jesus. And then here in chapter 21, verses 4 and 11, we find the record of two further warnings. In verse 4, through the Spirit, the people of Tyre urged Paul not to go on to Jerusalem. In verse 11, it's even more dramatic. A prophet called Agabus takes Paul's belt, and then, I was going to take mine off there, but you don't want that to happen, and illustrate the point. He takes Paul's belt, and he wraps it round, and he pretends that he's tying his own hands and his own feet, and he says, listen to what he says, the Holy Spirit says, in this way, the Jews of Jerusalem will bind the owner of this belt and will hand him over to the Gentiles. Now, what are you to make of this? I know some respected Bible teachers, they read this and they say, Paul was disobedient here. Paul should not have gone to Jerusalem. Holy Spirit was warning him. He should listen to his friends. They were telling him not to go to Jerusalem. In fact, one highly respected Bible teacher in his study on this chapter calls this chapter, or this section, when a good man fails. Is that what you think is going on here? You think the Apostle Paul is failing here? Because the argument is that here is the Apostle, and in his overconfidence, in an excess of zeal, he is foolishly refusing to listen to the Spirit's voice, and he's disobeying the Holy Spirit. Do we think that's what's going on? Let's reflect on that just for a moment. Is Paul the kind of person who would do that? Well, we know people who, generally speaking, in their life are not the kinds of people who would disobey the will of God, but we know that they have fallen. They have fallen into sin. Good people who normally do the will of God can, at some point in their life, do the abnormal thing and disobey the will of God. We know that happens. It happens to us. It happens to others. But the interesting thing is, if you go back and you look at chapter 19, verse 21, and then at chapter 20, verse 22, which talk about the journey to Jerusalem, on both those occasions, both the decision to go to Jerusalem and the compulsion to go to Jerusalem, both of those things are said in the text to be en to pneumati, in other words, in the spirit, that Paul's decision to go to Jerusalem, Paul's compulsion to go to Jerusalem, are both said in those passages to be in the spirit. In other words, that the firm conviction that he was meant to go to Jerusalem was both the right thing to do and the will of God for him. And I would argue that there is nothing in all the other warnings that indicates that along with the revelation, this is what will happen, that there was a command or a word from God saying, and you shall not go, or I don't want you to go, or you must not go. You don't get any of that. All you have is a revelation of what will happen. That in fact, what we have here in this story are people interpreting the revelation, and they're interpreting it wrongly. They're interpreting it wrongly. Why? Because they love Paul. I mean, if you heard that somebody you love dearly is going into a situation that is dangerous and they're going to die there, wouldn't you want them not to go? Wouldn't you want them not to go? Of course you would. Would you try and persuade them not to go? Of course you would. And that's what these people are doing for Paul. Let me put it like this. These are some points for us to consider. Paul understood, you see, that the will of God is sometimes not easy. I've no doubt that some of the believers then, like some of us today, feel that the will of God can be gauged by things falling into place for us. You know the idea. The thinking goes like this, if I can apply it to this section here. If Paul goes to Jerusalem, he's going to suffer. Therefore, that can't be right. Behind this is a logical syllogism. God wants me happy. If I am unhappy, I am not in his will. That's very often the way we think, isn't it? So we look at this story and we see here are these people telling Paul, you go there, you're going to suffer. Therefore, you shouldn't go. So why should you suffer? Here's how Oswald Chambers puts it. He says, the biblical understanding can be summed up like this. To choose to suffer, for you to make a decision, I am going to suffer for Jesus, tells me that there's something wrong with you. You need to go and see a psychiatrist. But for you to say, I choose God's will, even if it involves suffering, is a very different thing. In other words, to look for suffering, to search it out, you're bananas. But to choose the will of God, even though that will may involve suffering, is the way of obedience. The way of Jesus, whether there's suffering involved or not. That's the first thing. The second thing is that our conviction about God's will is often tested by the most unlikely sources. So we know that Paul has already come to the conviction in the Spirit that he should go to Jerusalem. And so he goes to Tyre and he meets Christian people there in this passage. He goes to Tyre and he meets friends of his. And they confuse the prediction with a prohibition. When Agabus makes his prophecy, you see that Paul is going to go and he's going to be tied up and so on. If Paul had listened to his friends and didn't go, then Agabus, the prophet, would have been disproved. He would have been discredited. We understand the psychology of these people very well. They know he's going to Jerusalem. They're weeping and breaking his heart. That's what he tells them. But he's saying to them, look, I cannot avoid what God wants me to do. He's told me to go to Jerusalem and then on to Rome. Maybe something is going to happen in Jerusalem that's going to get me to Rome. It was. But he's prepared for the will of God. So he says to them, verse 13, it's a key verse in the whole passage. I am ready, he says, I'm ready not only to be bound, which is what Agabus predicted, but to die in Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus. In other words, his friends are motivated by their love for Paul, and Paul is motivated by his love for the Lord Jesus. And his love for the Lord Jesus overrides every other consideration. He is willing to risk his life for the Lord Jesus. Dean Farrar, an old Anglican minister, wrote this: those whose intentions towards us are the best are the most dangerous to us when their intentions are merely human. How often a man's enemies are those of his own household. Their friends who love them best become in their worldliness their worst enemies. They drag them down from the heights of self-sacrifice to the vulgar, the conventional, and the comfortable. And verse 13 in this passage shows us how they tore at his heart. They constituted a temptation to the apostle. He's saying to them, why are you weeping and breaking my heart? Because I'm doing this thing. Don't you see? I have to do this thing, and I'm ready for whatever the implications are if I go to Jerusalem. Well, their final acquiescence in verse 14 seems to indicate that they recognized that he was right and they were wrong. And that's confirmed later on in chapter 23, verse 11, when God visits Paul in prison and says to him, take courage, God says, as you have testified to me in Jerusalem, so you must also testify in Rome. Now, throughout this whole experience, Paul has a get-out-of-jail-free card. He could choose not to go to Jerusalem. He could just choose to listen to his friends. He had that choice. What happens to a believer is you're liberated. You're liberated. You're given freedom. You're given freedom to choose. It's one of the effects of the new birth. One of the effects of the new birth is that you now have a will that has been liberated by Christ. You're free to choose the truth. And Paul was free. He was free not to go. But he chose the will of God. I think of two great Germans, Martin Luther and Dietrich Bonhoeffer. Martin Luther, when he was called to trial at Worms for his faith, all his friends were saying to him, Dr. Luther, don't go, don't go. You know, they're going to kill you if you go. You mustn't go. You'd be foolish. You'd be threatening the whole Reformation if you go there, threatening your own life. He says, I don't care if there's devils in every one of the rooftops of Worms, I'm going to go there because God wants me to go there. Or Dietrich Bonhoeffer. He was lecturing in New York City. He could have stayed in New York City lecturing, but he chose to go back to Nazi Germany. He did not want to sit in the sidelines while his own people, his own nation, suffered. And so he goes back to Germany. Although from the very beginning, from the very election of Adolf Hitler, he has spoken out against Hitlerism in Germany. And he returns to his fatherland to give leadership during those dark days of war, knowing that he was putting his life at risk for the gospel. And what made Paul and Luther and Bonhoeffer great is that they knew the will of God and they did it. Paul is willing to risk his life for the gospel. Well, the second little section tells us that he was also willing to risk his reputation for the gospel. Because if going to Jerusalem was a threat to his life, his actions when he gets there have raised a whole number of questions in the minds of Christian people. Did he do the right thing? There are some people who say he did the wrong thing. What does he do? He gets there, And he hears the very good news that God has been doing a great work among the Jews of Jerusalem. In fact, by this stage, we have to say that Jerusalem is fast becoming a Christian city. And by AD 70, the population of Jerusalem, there is no doubt, has an enormous Christian element to it already. And they praise God in verse 20. They praise God for this amazing growth in the gospel there. Verse 20 tells us, James reports, "See how many thousands of Jews have believed." But James also reports this, that among these Jewish believers, the idea was going around among them that the Apostle Paul was teaching Jews who lived outside of Jerusalem in Gentile areas, he was teaching them not to circumcise their sons or to live according to Jewish customs. Now, there's a sense in which there was an element of truth in that, but the way they were positioning that truth was wrong. What Paul was doing in these other places is that he was flexible. He was telling people that they were free as believers. They were no longer bound to these customs of the Jews. They were free either to continue them or not continue them, because either continuing them or not continuing had absolutely no relevance whatsoever to their salvation. They were free to do it, free not to do it. After all, there they were, living in the transitional period where Judaism, which was God's revealed religion, is moving into Christianity, which is the fulfillment of God's revelation to the Jews. So they're in that in-between time. And in that in-between time, that's a massive shift going on, especially for believing Jews. And they're in the middle of that, in the cockpit of that decision. And Paul had never told Jews to stop being Jews. He never told Christian Jews that they must not circumcise their sons. God had commanded all Israelites, as Israelites, to circumcise their sons. And so many Christian Jews, therefore, still felt conscience bound to continue with this rite, not in order to gain salvation, not to gain salvation. They already knew that that didn't do them any good. They already knew that circumcision had been taken over by baptism in the Christian sense, but they still felt that as Jews, as Israelites, as part of the Jewish family, that they should retain that right, not for salvation purposes, but simply to please the Lord. Now, Paul was always clear that that was fine. He was also clear that Gentiles did not have to circumcise. They did not need to become Jews in order to become Christians. And that was clear as well. So when he gets to Jerusalem, he's told about this thing. James asks him if he will do something to alleviate this misrepresentation that's going around. Will he take a vow? Will he pay for other people to take a vow, a Nazarite vow? And Paul figures, well, this has nothing to do with salvation. This is not an issue of what you need to do in order to become a Christian. This has nothing whatsoever to do with your obedience to Jesus Christ. This is, at this point, a conscience issue. And Paul decides, on the basis of it being a conscience issue, that he will go along with it, and he does. He does here. He goes. In fact, what he does is fulfill his own words to the Romans when he says, "We who are strong ought to bear with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves. Each of us should please his neighbor for his good, to build him up, for even Christ did not please himself." This was not a business of compromise. He wasn't compromising any Christian truth or doctrine. He was not compromising the gospel. He was not encouraging people to go back into Judaism. He was not trying to be culturally relevant to get the gospel into the Jewish religion. He was acting on behalf of his fellow believers whose consciences were in the process of transitioning out of Judaism at this point in the history of salvation into Christianity. And he acts on their behalf. Now, there's a sense in which the specifics of that action of Paul don't apply today. Time has passed. The transitional period is over. The apostles died. Christianity is the new Israel. Israel continues. It continues. It hasn't been replaced. It continues. Believing Jews have been joined by believing Gentiles in the Israel of God. This language of replacement theology isn't the Bible language. It's not that we've replaced Israel. We have been, by God's grace, joined to the believing Israel. By God's grace, we are the also-rans. We are and the Gentiles who've been added to the Israel of God, which is the believing Israel. The believing Israel. But there are other things in our lives. There are other areas, conscience areas, that have nothing to do with salvation, but we all have our hang-ups and issues and so forth. And in the way this works out in the church is that we give space to each other. We don't impose our will on other people. But my question this evening is this, as I close. Very often this action of Paul is taken, hijacked by some modern missiologists. And the language of the Jew-Gentile question is taken up and applied in our day to the Muslim-Christian question. And so there is a missiologist position today that says that Muslims can remain Muslims and still trust in Jesus. Can you do that? I would say you cannot do that because their customs are not simply cultural icons. They are religious icons. Their practices are not simply adiaphora, that is, things that are indifferent. They don't matter. They matter a lot. And they matter a lot in this regard, that they are connected to a religion which specifically, inherently, is anti-Christ. Islam is an anti-Christ movement. It rejects the deity of Jesus Christ. It rejects God as Trinity. You cannot compromise with something like that. This whole language that's used today about the Abrahamic religions, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, is a nonsense. There's only one Abrahamic religion, the Judeo-Christian Abrahamic religion. Islam is a false religion led by a false prophet. And we cannot compromise with that. The Bible says about the Jews, salvation is of the Jews. The whole of Jewish history in the scriptures has found its fulfillment in Christ. You can't apply what Paul is doing here in any other missiological context today in the same way in which it's used in this transitional moment from Judaism into Christianity. That doesn't mean we're to be insensitive as we try to reach the world for Christ, as we try to be relevant to people. But let me just say this. All our cultural relevance, all our attempts to connect with people in our culture today will not make the unbelieving world any more or less resistant to the gospel than it is. The reality is, the man without Christ, the woman without Christ, is ironclad in their resistance to the gospel until the Spirit of God opens their eyes to see and their ears to hear, their hearts to embrace, their wills to obey the Lord Jesus. And what that takes, let me tell you this, is not fancy programs of cultural relativization. What it takes is prayer. It takes prayer for the Spirit of God to do what the Spirit of God does with mighty power, opening the eyes of the blind and the ears of the deaf to hear the good news of Jesus. Here's Paul. He's willing to risk his life and his reputation for the gospel. Let's pray. Father, we pray that by your grace, you'd enable us to see the areas of our lives where faith manifests itself as risk. Maybe at work tomorrow. where we risk a friendship by saying what we believe. Or we risk a promotion by expressing an opinion in the boardroom. Risk comes into faith as we live it out in our lives. We pray that we'd resolve tonight, however that appears in our own circumstances, that like Paul, we'd be able to say, I'm ready not only to be bound, but also to die. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's all pray together. Father, it is good to sing that in Jesus, goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives. Father, as we continue to worship you with our money, we pray, Father, that you would give us hearts of great thankfulness, that you would loosen the binds of our hearts on the things of this world and set us free to give freely, to live risky because of the gospel. Father, we pray that you would take these monies and you would use them to advance the work of your church, to spread the good news of the Lord Jesus, crucified and risen for sinners. And we pray all this in his name. Amen.
In a moment, we're going to share the Lord's Supper together. And if you have your bulletin with you at your side, it'd be good. We're going to have a question of preparation. And I'm going to read the question, and then you can read the answer. What's a catechism? It's a teaching tool that the church has used throughout its history to instruct people about who God is, who we are, who Jesus is. And I want to say one thing here about this question of preparation. Why do we do that? You cannot prepare enough for this meal. Do not think that what we're doing right now is somehow qualifying ourselves to enjoy this. What we're doing is simply reminding ourselves of what God has done to prepare this meal for us. And the question we're going to look at tonight is about creation and providence, and how can it help us? There's a very simple answer to that. In this answer, we'll read that there's nothing that can separate us from God's love. And the only reason we can say that with confidence is because Jesus was separated from his Father's love for sinners like us and anyone who would put their faith in him. And that's what this meal is meant to remind us of. So I'm going to read the question, and then we can all read together the answer. How does the knowledge of God's creation and providence help us? We can be patient when things go against us, thankful when things go well, and for the future we can have good confidence in our faithful God and Father, that nothing will separate us from his love. All creatures are so completely in his hand that without his will, they can neither be nor be moved.
And as we come to the table, I want to invite all those who know and love the Lord Jesus to take part of these elements together. This is where the gospel, as it were, is thrust into our hands and into our mouths as God reaches out to us, as he demonstrates his love for us, as he gives us these tokens that feed us and sustain us through our brief, uncertain life and pilgrimage and prepare us for the glory that is yet to come. They're the hors d'oeuvres. They're the starters, if you will. They're the pointers towards that great banquet that Jesus is preparing for his people in celebration of us all being together on that final day. So we break bread together. We take the cup together. It's a together thing, not a private individual thing. You don't do this with your eyes closed, not looking at your brothers and sisters. This is a family thing. This is something we do with one another as part of the family of God. So look around you. Look at this motley crew who are sitting in this room this evening, and consider the grace of God in the gospel, that he takes people like us who perhaps would have nothing in common in our normal everyday lives, and he puts us together in the bundle of life that he calls the church. And he's calling people from every nation and language and race into this great family. And even as we gather at this table, consider that if you could take the roof off this evening, you would see that we are joined by a company that is innumerable. Angels and archangels in glorious assembly, the church of the firstborn, whose names are written in heaven. We're part of this global church of Christ that spans the ages and wraps round the globe as we come to this table. So let's come in thanksgiving, and let's come with anticipation of the day when we will all be together for that feast that Jesus is preparing. Well, we remind ourselves that on the night in which he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread and he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you."
bread of heaven is life for the world. Let's eat with thanksgiving. In the same manner also, Jesus took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood." The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ cleanses us from all unrighteousness. Let's drink with thanksgiving. Using your bulletin, let's proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. Thanks be to God. Now may grace, mercy, and peace from God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest and remain with you now and evermore. God be with you.